You know, I just want to say, Fred would be disappointed. You guys are all. And he thought he had you trained. The title of the sermon today is Thank You, Jesus. And I want us to all focus a little bit on, because we all fall short from the grace of God. He blesses us every day. You know, there was a storm that just ravaged up the coast. And it was difficult. It was an act of nature. And we prayed. But God saw that many of our people were safe. Safe from harm. My daughter included. I know Sarah Gertie's down there. Many other folks are down there. We all prayed for them. And then, yeah, they may have had some water damage, but, you know, we are blessed. And we need to remember and thank God for our blessings. Then one of them, when he saw he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice and giving him thanks. And if you ever doubted the importance of saying thank you to someone when a thank you is due, consider the story, which is our text for the sermon. Luke tells us that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem, and as he passed near Galilee and Samaria, he was met by 10 lepers. They called out to him, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Jesus sent them on to the priest, and as they went there, the lepers were healed. Now, most people would focus on the healing part of this scripture reading today. Jesus said, "Your faith has made you well," and certainly whole sermons could be preached on the relationship between faith and healing and the relationship between the body and the Holy Spirit, which makes up for a healthy person. "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." But today, in this sermon, I want to focus on another part of the story, which has to do with gratitude. There were 10 lepers healed that day, yet only one came back to say thank you to Jesus. Only one of 10. The other 9 lepers were healed too. But they still weren't healthy in the whole sense, since none of them had a thankful heart. Lest we miss the drama involved, it might help to recall the kind of disease that we're talking about here. Leprosy is still a problem in India, of course, where Mother Teresa worked with lepers for many years. It still stalks part of Africa and Asia. But leprosy has largely disappeared from the Western world. So we tend to forget what a terrible and terrifying disease that it is. You see, you can carry the disease for years before the symptoms ever appear. But leprosy first appears as nodules on the skin, which grow larger and larger, until they force deep wrinkles all over your body. Then your lips and your nose and your ears grow thicker until your face begins to resemble that of an animal. You get ulcerations all over your body, which cause your arms and legs to be horribly mutilated. You start losing your fingers and your toes, and as the disease continues to progress, you're left blind. As if the disease isn't cruel enough, there was also social ostracism. Even in the Bible, there were strict rules given for dealing with lepers. Their situation was even worse than what happened to many AIDS victims today. When you were diagnosed a leper, you were completely cut off from the community. You had to wear mourning clothes, as if you were already dead. In a sense, you were. You kept your head uncovered, your lips veiled, and everywhere you went, you had to yell out, "Unclean! Unclean!" in order to warn others from getting near you. You lived outside the village, in caves or in open pits, reserved just for the leper community. You spent your days begging for food, and your nights just waiting to die. So, when we hear the story of the 10 leopards, it's hard to understand why all 10 of the leopards didn't come running back in joy just to thank Jesus, to let him know how much they appreciated his gift of healing. I should think they had spent years just looking for Jesus, if that's how long it took until they found the man who had freed them from the merciless disease, and thanked him face to face. You know, we like to be thanked for the things that we do for other people. Even Jesus himself wanted to be thanked. He said to one leper who did return, "Were there not 10 men who were healed? Where are the other 9? The one that came back was a Samaritan. So why is this foreigner the only one who came back to give thanks to God? Even if our own problems aren't as severe as the lepers, our text makes us think about the ways we are not as thankful as maybe we really should be. I think most of us are like the 9 leopards in the story. Our hearts aren't thankful enough. We don't say thank you often enough for the kindness, large and small, which are given to us every day. You've all heard of Dear Abby and her newspaper columns. Well, one day, Dear Abby suggested that her readers write a thank you to a school teacher who made the difference in their lives. I know there are many school teachers out here, so they probably may have a story similar to this, or would have appreciated a story similar to this. Shortly after that, she received a letter which, one day, Dear Abby suggested that her readers write a thank you to a school teacher who had made a difference in their life. And shortly after that, a woman had received a letter which really showed the importance of saying thank you. Dear Abby, the letter said, "You can imagine how thrilled I was to receive a letter from a student I had taught 62 years ago. He wanted to thank me for staying after school to teach him how to tell time when he was just in second grade. Abby, I'm 95 years old, and I live in a nursing home. I don't expect to have many more surprises as happy as this thank you. You can even be thankful during the most difficult circumstances in life. It's true. We see an especially inspiring example of a brave and thankful heart in the story behind one of church's most popular hymns, 'Now Thank We All Our God.' The story behind this hymn goes like this. It was written during the 30-year war in Germany in the early 1600s. Its author was Martin Rinkhart, a Lutheran pastor in the town of Ellenberg in Saxony. Now, Ellenberg was a walled city, so it became a haven for refugees seeking safety from the fighting. But soon the city became too crowded, and food was short in short supply. And then a famine hit, and to make matters worse, a terrible plague. And Ellenberg became a giant morgue. In 1 year alone, Pastor Anker conducted funerals for 4,500 people, including his own wife. The war dragged on and the suffering continued, yet through it all, he never lost courage or faith. And even during the darkest days of Ellenberg's agony, he was able to write this hymn. Now thank we all our God, with hearts and hands and voices, whose wondrous things hath done, in whom the world rejoices. So keep us in his grace and guide us when perplexed, and free us from all ills in this world and the next. Even when he was waist deep in destruction, Pastor Rinkert was able to lift his sights to a higher plane. He kept his mind on God's love when the world was filled with hate. He kept his mind on God's promises of heaven when the earth was a living hell. Can we not do the same? We whose lives are almost trouble-free compared with the man who had just written that hymn. Who can you say thank you to? As you look back on your life, who are the people who helped you along the way? Who are the people near and dear to you who are helping you today? The people in your own family, your home, the very people you might be taking for granted. I tell you, there is no such thing as a self-made man or a self-made woman. Everyone has people to thank for helping them in their living day to day. Could the people who helped to shape your life be a teacher? A Sunday school teacher, maybe? Could it be your grandmother? A neighbor? A coach? Your mom or dad? Your brother, your sister? Our lives have been molded from the very day, the very moment that we took our first breath, by meaningful people who helped us get to this very moment where we are right now. We do have a lot to be thankful for and a lot of thank yous to give away when we think about our lives like that. We also have a larger lesson to remember, a larger reason to give thanks, because every time we receive a gift of caring or concern from someone else, we receive that gift from God. When my son had graduated from high school, I asked him to tell me the most influential teachers that helped him along the way. He named four teachers. His second grade teacher, Pat Tyerson, who helped to identify that he had a type of dyslexia. His resource room, Mrs. Recruzzi, who pushed him to go beyond his potential. And one other thing, for a teenage boy, she was gorgeous, and he just loved going to see her. That was probably his real motivation. His math teacher, Tom Miller, who took time out of his Christmas and summer vacation to tutor him so he could switch from a non-Regents class in ninth grade to a Regents class in the middle of the school year. My mother had to drive him over to his home just to try to get him up to speed with the Regents class that he was about to take when he came back to school in January. And then lastly, Mrs. Jean Bendix, who gave him a love for music and theater. We wrote each of these teachers a thank you to just let them know how important they were to him. 10 years ago, I received a thank you from an 11-year-old child, Nolan Anthony. I hadn't seen him in over 6 years. Now mind you, I only saw this boy until he was about 5 years old. I had known Nolan from a music intergenerational program that we did. For 3 years, he'd come over to the nursing home on a weekly basis for this music program with our nursing home residents. He loved the program, and I watched him grow from being a very shy, withdrawn toddler who sat in the back of the room right next to his teacher, to a very warm, sweet young toddler, young boy, who absolutely loved music and moved up right next to me. When he turned 5 on his birthday, which actually is my dad's birthday, April 29th, if I remember that, I gave him a cassette tape, because cassettes were popular back then. And it had my music on it. And some years had passed by, and he went on to school. And in 2006, I'm sorry, I received this letter from Nolan in the mail. And this thank you meant so much to me. I've saved it all these years, and I'll share it with you now. Dear Beth, I just dug out a tape you gave me for my birthday. I started to make me think about all the good times I had in preschool. I really miss you guys. When I listened to the tape, I almost went into tears. Love, Nolan Anthony. P.S. I play the drums, and I'm in 6th grade. Well, I figure by now Nolan's got to be 21 or 22. And he not only played the drums, he played the drums in the Savannah Cellar Savers group band since he was a young teenager and was the youngest member of the band. And I'm sure if you've seen the Savannah Cellar Savers marching in the Peppermint Parade, that you may have seen Nolan banging away on the drums. It's important for us to acknowledge those who helped us along the way. In fact, maybe we should take a few minutes this week just to reach out and say thank you and acknowledge those people who have touched our lives. It might just be a friendly smile from a stranger or the cheerful service at a crowded checkout counter. The doctor who goes out of her way make you feel at ease. The loved one who makes an important sacrifice for you. These and 100 other kindnesses are all examples of the love and kindness of God. They're the reasons for us to say, thank we all, our God, because God expresses his love through the love of others. I know that you remember the Bible verse where Jesus says, because we remember that Christ said, when we have done it for the least of these, you have done it for me. God also expresses his love and care directly to us without any help from anyone else, solely by the presence of the Spirit of his Son, Jesus Christ. Can we not also be thankful for that? It's easy to take the goodness of our loved ones for granted, just as easy it is to take our Lord's goodness for granted. And that's what happened with the 9 lepers who met Jesus as he walked to Jerusalem one day. They all received a priceless miracle. Yet they went on their way without saying thanks. God blesses us every day. Don't take God's gifts, God's grace, for granted. You see, we don't want to be like the 9 that went on their way. We want to be like that one leper who came back to Jesus, like that leper our minds our eyes have beheld his love. We won't be satisfied. We won't be spiritually healed until we can find him and praise him face to face. But in the meantime, he has given us the grace to live the rest of our lives in the fullness of joy with a thankful heart. Amen.